Hi, welcome to episode 16 of the podcast. I hope you're doing well. That feels like such a redundant thing to say because nobody's really doing well, especially after what happened this past week, you know. This is going to be a slightly difficult episode to get through because it hits so close to home. So please bear with me. COVID-19 was supposed to be the worst thing that happened to us this year, but death just went, hey guys, hang on. I'm not going to let a virus with a lame-ass mortality rate steal my thunder. And I don't know, you know, like, dude, I've stopped washing my hands, okay? Like, why even bother? Now I just go to the wash basin and I go, you know, at least I'm saving water. We need a win, you know. It's like we need something we can cheer about, you know. This is not a win. I don't know who these gentlemen are. Apparently, they are from Surat and they are really mad at China. Dear sir from the balcony, if you are watching this, I just want you to know that the TV you just threw out was already paid for. So China already has your money. When you smash the TV, the money does not come back into your account. That's not how refunds work. Now you'll have to go and buy a brand new TV, which will most likely send more money to China because invariably everything is made there. And while you're out making purchases, may I recommend getting yourself a new brain? Okay, I'm going to give you some show updates quickly. So I'm doing Daniel Fernandez Jokes from the Vault next weekend as well, or this coming weekend. I think you might still get tickets for tonight's show. Just check the ticket link in the description. It has all the shows listed. Okay. So today's episode is about depression. For those of you who don't know, depression is a mental illness that makes people say nice things about you after you kill yourself. Symptoms range from people telling you that it's all in your head, asking you to stay positive, to your parents wondering what the neighbors will think if you go to therapy. It's pretty common. A lot of people around the world are dealing with it. Sushant Singh Rajput died by suicide this past week. Okay, he was suffering from depression. He was 34 and a brilliant man by all accounts. And this is what I find funny, you know, the media didn't talk about all this while he was alive. Like, I didn't know that he loved astronomy and quantum physics and that he has this telescope that he used to see the rings on Saturn. Like, having your own telescope is so badass. Like, his friends could never lie to him. Like, yeah, Sushant, I'm coming. I'm on my way. I'll be there in 5 minutes. Yeah. Fucker, I can see you, okay? You're still in bed. There's no way you're getting here in 5 minutes. Also, please tell Karan that jacket is really gaudy. It looks like a packet of M&Ms threw up on it. He owned a piece of land on the moon. Dude, I didn't even know you could do that. Apparently, a piece of land on the moon costs $20 an acre. For $20... in Bandra, you can get 2 drinks at Monkey Bar. And I think owning property on the moon is such a great flex. You know, if you're just hanging out with your friends and they go, hey man, have you thought about investing on property? Like, yeah, dude, I just bought 20 acres of land on the moon. It's right there. Look, what the fuck are you doing with your life, huh? Mira Road. But the media never talked about this, you know? Like, all we got about him was some blind items about how he couldn't handle fame and he was an alcoholic and throwing tantrums and living a debauched lifestyle. Like, blind items are toxic journalism, you know? Like, I admit, like, I'm guilty of having enjoyed them. You know, I used to read them and go like, ooh, who fucked up now, you know? And I think so many of us read that shit and we kind of forgot that these people that are being bitched about are also human, you know. Now I think blind items are just tools used by Bollywood biggies to slander people they don't like. Who knows? When the news broke out, the country was in shock, you know, like, not so much because we lost a brilliant actor at a really young age, but because some news channels who broke the news to us thought that today is the day that they would give 110%. You know, they were like, we will not just report the news from our studios. We will send a reporter to Sushant's home in Patna and ask his father how he feels about losing his son to suicide. Because nothing exudes class and sensitivity like sticking a microphone in the face of a man whose son has just died. Well done, Aaj Tak. Aaj Tak is so committed to TRPs that if their cameras were fireproof, they would stick them into the funeral pyre as well, you know? Like, they ran a ticker that said, "Aise kaise hit wicket ho gaya Sushant." As a viewer, the only appropriate response to watching something like that on your TV would be this. The film industry started talking about Sushant's passing and then slowly all hell broke loose. You know, Bollywood ke papa Karan Johar wrote this fake crocodile tears post about how he should have kept in touch with Sushant, and then Nikhil Dwivedi rightly asked him to shut the fuck up. You know, like, the guy wrote this whole spiel about how Sushant's death was a huge wake-up call and how he should foster and protect his equations, but he didn't go to the funeral. You know, because he was busy with the script of Student of the Year 3. Then Abhinav Kashyap wrote a Facebook post about how Salman Khan and his family bullied him and tried to ruin his career over the last 10 years, you know. Like, Abhinav, I'm glad you spoke up about this, but if you're ever taking an evening stroll, please don't walk on the footpath. And then one thing led to another, and this whole nepotism debate started all over again, and people started saying that nepotism and bullying drove Sushant to suicide, you know. Is that true? I don't know. It's speculation at best, because Sushant didn't leave behind a suicide note, so we will never know what his triggers were. But as someone who deals with mental illness on a daily basis, let me offer you some perspective, okay? Depression and anxiety are not just intrinsic illnesses, you know, like, if you have diabetes, it doesn't matter where you are or what you do or who you talk to, it plays out in the same manner all over, you know. But with a mental illness, a lot of your treatment, recovery and management is heavily dependent on extrinsic factors like your workspace, your family, your friends, where you live, you know. So is Bollywood a cesspool of toxicity? Yes. Is bullying rampant in Bollywood? Yes. So while we don't know why Sushant took his own life, it would be ignorant to dismiss what having to survive in an industry that is extremely unkind to outsiders can do to your mental health and stability. You know? I don't know if bullying is why Sushant lost his life. Depression is definitely the prime suspect, but bullying is often, in cases like these, a willing accomplice. So while everyone is talking about mental health right now, I think it would be fair to examine how we treat people around us. That's all, you know. By the way, if nepotism in Bollywood really bothers you, here's a fun fact, okay? Do you know who the biggest patrons of nepotism are? It's us. we are the ones who keep giving star kids chances over and over again while the outsiders are ignored. You want to change that? Let's start supporting the talented outsiders by buying tickets for their movies. Like, I've decided now to only buy tickets for movies that have a non-star kid cast. For the movies that have a star kid cast, I will pirate them. And it's the same thing with other art forms as well, you know, like support live music, you know, poetry, theater, comedy. Like, don't buy tickets to shows that only have famous names, you know, like take a chance on someone you haven't heard of. And who knows, you know, they may surprise you. Like, and even if you don't enjoy yourself, at least you didn't give your money to Karan Johar. I honestly feel sorry for anyone who has a mental illness and then has to survive in show business. And it's not just Bollywood. A lot of the things that people are mad about with the film industry is pretty rampant in the comedy industry as well. This whole the insiders and the outsiders exists in our scene too. Like, in comedy, people who have supposedly made it are seen as insiders. People who are trying to make it are seen as outsiders. Then there are groups and cliques, and you will see a lot of opportunities not coming to some comics because they are not part of certain circles. It's a messy space, you know? And while I do understand that not everybody can do everything, there is this sense of togetherness with a certain group of people and solitude or loneliness with others. And if you're a young comic right now and you're trying to get on the inside, so to say, you know, and you feel unwelcome or anything, and that's getting you down in any way, don't let that happen. You know, acceptance is an illusion. All these people care about are views, subscribers, and ticket sales. That is the basis on which they choose their friends in this business. Okay, when you're a nobody, they don't give a shit about you. You walk into a green room, they make you feel unwelcome and out of place. And then suddenly you have a couple of videos go viral and you have new friends. You know, like, I watch stories about how comics change their behavior after finding success and they start treating people differently because of that. It's so fickle and sad, you know. Like, we've somehow been led to believe that there is only one path to succeed in this business. Like, you have to get on a certain show, you have to be signed by a certain company, you have to be seen with certain comics. No, you don't, okay? There are quite a few of us who haven't taken that path and are doing just fine. Nobody owns this art form. No company, no individual, no group. So cut the noise, you know, just cut out the noise, you know, like, just get on stage, get good with your work, put your work out there and let your fans find you and then run with it. You know, it's a long, arduous journey, but if you put in the time and are good at what you do, you will get there eventually. You know, there's a lot of toxicity in the comedy scene. Like, somebody asked me the other day, they were like, Dan, how do you manage being a part of this industry, you know? And I just said to him, you know, if the comedy scene is a country, I have a small island of my own, a few miles out at sea, you know? It's really nice, you know, there are beaches, palm trees and cabanas. And I go to the mainland once in a while, but I spend most of my time on that island and I've learned to be happy, you know? And similarly, there are other comics who also have their own islands. Find your island. So coming back to what I was saying earlier, you know, I think people are gunning for nepotism right now because they're trying to make sense of what happened. You know, it's hard to process the death of someone who seemingly occupied a strong position in life. Like, think about this, like, you know, like, Sushant's worst case scenario as an actor would still be a best case scenario for most of us. And this is why it's so important to understand how an illness like depression works, you know. Like, somebody on my friend list a couple of days ago posted this, you know, after Sushant's death. She said, suicide is the most cowardly thing to do. He was heartbroken, felt cornered, felt rejection, was lonely, and to deal with this, ending his life was his only solution. dude, what about being a survivor? Why no fighting spirit? Fuck mental illness. There are hundreds of people who go through shit every day in their lives and live on with the worst of situations to deal with, but they live on without giving up. All of us have our own shit to deal with. If anyone I know is depressed, please don't expect any advice from me. Grow up and deal with your crap like the rest of us. This made me very angry when I read it, you know, because I have lived this. A lot of you watching this have lived this. But I also understand that there is a lot of ignorance about mental health. You know, there's a lot of stigma surrounding it, which is why people are so scared to come out and say that they're going through something. This stigma is also the reason why people say stupid shit like this. And it's not just this one person. You know, there are a lot of people around us, friends, family, neighbors, who feel the same way. And they've all said stuff like this in at some point or the other. So let me try and break it down with an analogy that is easy to relate to. Okay. Have you lost a family member to cancer? You have, right? Everyone has. Everyone knows someone who had cancer and lost their lives to it, you know? When somebody dies of cancer, nobody says, what a coward. Couldn't he have been a little stronger, you know? How could he let cancer beat him? Couldn't he have a better attitude about it? You don't say that, right? Are you with me so far? Great. So depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, etc. These are all cancers of the mind, and some of them, if not treated correctly, may result in death. These are not a figment of people's imaginations. This is very, very real. Okay, it can be medically diagnosed and treated. But because we live in a society that does not understand this, many people suffering from it suffer in silence. And then when they die by suicide, we go, oh, what the fuck? How did this happen? Death by suicide because of depression is not a rational choice. It is an organic outcome. It is not an action born out of selfishness. It is an action born out of self-preservation. A friend of mine shared this beautiful quote by a novelist called David Foster Wallace, who was also suffering from depression and eventually died by suicide. You know, I'm taking a few liberties and paraphrasing here, but this is how he explains suicide caused by depression. When the depression reaches a certain unendurable level, a person will kill himself the same way a trapped person will eventually jump from the window of a burning high-rise. The terror of falling from a great height is still just as great as it would be for you or me standing speculatively at the same window just checking out the view. The variable here is the other terror, the fire's flames. When the fire's flames get close enough, falling to death becomes slightly less terrible than being burned alive. And yet, nobody down on the sidewalk, looking up and yelling, "Don't!" and "Hang on!" can understand the jump. You'd have to have personally been trapped and felt the flames to really understand a terror way scarier than falling. When you say something like people who commit suicide because of depression gave up on life, you're coming from a place of arrogance. An arrogance where you think that you're in control of your life and that you will die at a place and time of your choosing. You know, preferably an old man or woman surrounded by your grandkids. Death is coming for all of us. And no matter how long you live, you will never be ready to give up on life. But I can assure you that when you least expect it, life will give up on you. So be kind to the ones that go before you. we do this thing, you know, where we read up on symptoms of certain illnesses that we fear, you know, like cancer or just in case. You should do the same thing for mental illness. You know, it is a very common illness, so the chances of it happening to you are very, very high. Read up on the symptoms, and if you feel that you are exhibiting even the tiniest amount, go get yourself checked, go see a professional, you know, see a doctor, get diagnosed. And if you need medication, take the medication on time. If you need therapy, get therapy. Do whatever is necessary, because I can assure you that this illness is very, very real. We will never know what triggered Sushant to do what he did, but we need to respect that he did it and let him go. Yeah. For all we know, he's probably chilling with Irfan on that piece of land on the moon, looking back at Earth, going, yaar, wo NASA wala photo pakka fake hai. And then Rishi yelling from a distance, boys, ek aur peg ho jaye. And that's the visual I want to leave you with. And with that, I'm going to wrap up this episode. I hope you liked it. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and share this episode on your social media. Follow me on Instagram. There's a pay-as-you-like option in case you want to pay for the podcast. The link in the description. Once again, I'm doing shows. There is one tonight. Check the ticket link. There might be a few seats left and a few in the coming weekend as well. Don't forget to leave your comments with suggestions for future episodes. Take care of yourself, guys. I will see you soon. This is Daniel Fernandez signing off. Goodbye.